Let every heart prepare him room. Heaven and nature sing, let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Hear the joyful sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. You rule the world with truth and grace, and make the nations prove of your love, the wonders of your love, the wonders, wonders of your love. Hear the joyful sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world a choir.
despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. But the bell ringing like a choir singing. Does anybody hear them? Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then rang the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor does he. A chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells they're ringing like a choir they're singing. And with our hearts we'll hear them.
Last week we heard the sad news that our friend Brian Revel, passed away. He was actually expected to pass away a year or more ago. He was only given a few months to live in mid-2019, but it was only last week when finally he went home. We went home to Jesus, and we're so grateful for his life and everything that he did at St. Peter's. He's a long-standing member of the congregation. He did so much to welcome the church plant and continue to work for the church when the church plant team arrived. He was always very keen to have the church building open. He liked to sit and talk to people who wanted to come in. And we're going to miss him a lot. The funeral is going to take place in early January, but of course, COVID restrictions mean that not all that many of us will be able to go, unfortunately. We will keep you posted on what happens with the funeral, and there may well also be a memorial service for him when the restrictions lighten up, hopefully next year sometime as well. In the meantime, please pray for the family. That's Sam, his daughter and her family, and his son Nick as well, and everyone who knew and loved him. Please pray God's blessing and consolation for them at what is always a difficult time. And let's just be thankful that he is now at home, at rest with Jesus. Rest in peace, Brian, and rise in glory. Amen.
Psalm 95. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the heights of the mountains are also his. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, as at Meribah, as on the day at Massah in the wilderness, when your fathers put me to the test and put me to the proof, though they had seen my work. For 40 years I loathed that generation and said, they are the people who go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Therefore I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest.
Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 till 11. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her, that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Go on up to a high mountain. O Zion, herald of good news, lift up your voice with strength. O Jerusalem, herald of good news, lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. May the Lord's words be blessed. Amen.
Hello again, everyone. Nice to be with you again today. Thank you for joining in, whether you're back in the church building or you're warm and comfortable at home. Thank you for taking part. Thank you for listening in today. Last week, Chris helpfully went through Isaiah chapter 40 with us and gave us some good advice on how to prepare for Christmas, how to prepare for Jesus in our lives. And this week I want to dig a bit deeper into Isaiah chapter 40, because they are such great words which are worth examining deeply in our hearts and minds. And I want to think especially about what it is that might hold us back from living out these words in our lives. The first two words in the passage always stand out to me. They've spoken to me personally many times. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. I think We often struggle to receive comfort. We struggle to believe in it. Often we talk about reality biting, reality kicking in, as if reality was always the worst about human life and human nature. To be sure, there are lots of things about human life and human nature which are pretty grim. That, after all, is why we need a saviour. But God here provides an update on reality for us. And it doesn't matter how bad or difficult that reality is. God has an update, which is good news. You may be struggling with all kinds of different things. There may be some short-term issues that mean you're too busy. There may be long-term issues, circumstances in your life that you've had to battle with month after month, year after year, maybe even decade after decade. Whatever the struggles, whatever the battles, whatever the difficult reality that you're facing, this passage talks about some good news, God's response, and God's offer of comfort, strength, renewal, right in the middle of those difficult circumstances. The question is, and it's the main question I want to raise today, the question is, are we willing? Are you willing? Am I willing to receive God's comfort right where I am, whatever it is I'm going through? Whatever it is I'm stuck with right now. Lots of us think that being anxious or worrying about circumstances in our lives mean that we care more, and it may in part be an indication that we're concerned about someone else and ourselves. But actually, when anxiety and concern grows to such a point that it debilitates our life, that it makes life hard and difficult for us, when it's counterproductive, when it doesn't change anything apart from making us anxious and restless, then we have to ask that question. Am I willing to receive God's comfort in place of my anxiety? This update on reality that God gives us is a living reality. It redefines reality for us. Reality isn't just the worst we know, but now also has to take account of the good reality of a good God who's done good and amazing things to help us. True, genuine comfort, strengthening, rest, peace, joy is now available. That's the good news of Isaiah 40. That's the good news of Christmas. That's the good news of Jesus and everything he's done to win us back and to love us into new life. The words in Isaiah 40 go on in a very powerful and memorable way. Verses 3 and 4 say, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up and every mountain and hill be laid low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places plain, and all this will reveal the glory of God." Now those words are, of course, on one level, are a metaphor. It's not just about roadworks and landscape gardening. It's about human life and human existence. Psalm 95 takes up both those themes as well. Psalm 95 gives us lots of really good reasons to praise and worship God. In fact, it's a great hymn, a great poem of praise to God. Come, let us sing to the Lord and make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. We can come into his presence with thanksgiving. There's so much to be grateful for. And we can and should make a joyful noise to him with our songs of praise. That's why praise and song worship is such an important part of what we do, not just on a Sunday, but hopefully at the rest of the week as well. Why do we do it? Well, it's because the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. And it's in his hands that the depths of the earth are. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his and he made it. His hands prepared, his hands formed the dry land. God certainly can do the roadworks and the landscape gardening. And when we look around us and at the world that we live in, even the area that we live in, we see so much to be amazed at and thankful for. When we look to the mountains and the skies, our wonder and appreciation grows even greater. When we look into the depths of the universe and see that it just goes on and on in mind-boggling ways, when we look at all of this, we get a little taste of how great God must really be. People quite often nowadays just write God off. They just assume, without any proof, that God doesn't exist and all this just magically happened somehow. Actually, I think the evidence of God's existence is already there, all around us, in those wonderful acts of creation that we can see. We too, ourselves, God created. We're part of that creation and he loves us very much. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, because he is our God. That psalm goes on, though, from great praise and worship and thanksgiving into a warning, a caution against the problem I think many of us have when we refuse to receive God's comfort. Verse 7. He is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. If you hear his voice, don't harden your heart to it. And the psalm goes on to talk about times in the history of God's people where hearts were hardened, and to talk about the really unpleasant and difficult consequences that came from that. Do not harden your hearts. When we're faced with all the difficulties that life can throw at us, when we're faced with what people think is the baseline of reality, the dark side, the rubbish, the things that go wrong, well, a natural defensive reaction is to protect our hearts, to harden them against possible further hurt. God says, don't do this. And when he says that, he isn't saying it just so that we can be run over by all the pressures and difficulties that this life comes. He says it because he knows the reality of who he is and what he's done is available to us. We can know God in the midst of all these difficulties. We can talk to him. We can hear from him. We can discover what he wants us to know right in the midst of all our difficulties, in our difficult situations and hard lives. If our hearts are hardened, though, we won't receive it. We won't believe it. We'll join in with those people who just write God off. And whether we say we believe in God or not, well, the effects will be the same. It'll be as if he doesn't exist. Remember, this is an update on reality. And that reality is that God is with us and he can speak to us and help us. We sometimes think that our lives are what it's all about, and that the problems and difficulties are so enormous that they are so much bigger than we are. One of the good things about this passage from Isaiah 40 is that it makes clear there is something much bigger and more powerful even than our transient lives. All flesh is grass, it says in verse 6. All its beauty is like the flower of the field, and when the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it, and it says, surely the people are like grass. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. All the difficulties, all the troubles are not half so big and as long-lasting as we think. What really lasts is what God says and does and thinks. His word, the word of God, is going to stand forever. So when he issues an update like this for us, we can take it seriously and take it to heart. We can receive the comfort and let our hardened hearts melt away. As we let God into our lives in new and deeper ways, and that is always a challenge for all of us, slowly but surely it can and it does change us. When we get to know God, when we listen to him, when we engage in this relationship with him where we're open to receive his word, his uplifting, affirming word to us. As we receive it, it'll change us. It'll change who we are and what we want to do. And we'll find ourselves caught up in his kingdom purposes here. We'll find that we are amongst those who are making the rough places plain and lowering the mountains and raising up the valleys. We'll become part of God's solution and part of the hope which he's seeking to provide to anyone and everyone who listen. So that's why when it says in verse 9 that there is good news which we can tell joyfully, well, it's true. Once God gets going in our lives, once we receive this comfort for ourselves, not just doing religious stuff, but knowing God, receiving comfort where we really most need it, where we're most broken, then we will change, and that news will be something we'll share almost without having to think about it, because it'll be clear in our lives and we'll want to talk about how good and great God is to other people. God is doing something. That's the big news that this passage in Isaiah foretells and which we see fulfilled in Jesus. Behold God, look at him. God is coming with might. His arm rules for him. His reward is with him. His recompense before him. God is mighty and powerful and strong, much more mighty and powerful and strong than even the worst of our troubles. The challenge is to receive that comfort, to believe that it's possible that things can be different, and to believe that it's possible that right in the thick of our difficulties, there is comfort and joy and peace and love to be received. Verse 11 in Isaiah 40 contrasts that image. Verse 10 talks about how mighty and powerful and strong and great God is. Verse 11 paints another picture of God in contrast, in complementing that strength of verse 10. Verse 11 says, he will tend his flock. That word tend, of course, comes in the word tender and tenderly. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them close to his heart and gently lead those that are with young. That's a wonderful contrast, a powerful contrast. It's one that we need in ourselves as well. And it's already powerfully there in God. He is powerful and mighty to sort things out. He is tender and loving to help us inside, deep in our broken hearts, so that they don't need to be hard anymore. God's toughness and strength is matched with his tenderness and kindness. In trouble, we often try to tough it out. That's not God's way. With God, there is real toughness and strength. And with God, there is also genuine tenderness. We need both aspects of God in us. We need to receive the comfort he brings, as well as the strong challenges he brings to us. I wonder, is this strong and tender God someone we know yet? Is he someone we can get to know better? What is it? Which troubles of ours is it that stand in the way of getting to know this God a bit more? There are so many things, and the truth is, it doesn't matter what they are. Right here and now, we can begin this journey of receiving the comfort that is offered to us, if only we'll listen, if only we won't harden our hearts. The dark stuff, the bad stuff, isn't the last word on reality. The goodness and greatness of God is the last word on reality, on the way things truly are. It's all there waiting for us. Perhaps we've begun to receive it. Perhaps this is a new idea to us, whichever. The challenge I want to share today is, will you receive it? Will I receive it? Will I receive it more into my heart and mind? So we're going to pray. And I just invite you to bring whatever's on your heart and mind, the troubles, the things that separate you from God and separate you from living well and peacefully in the midst of life's inevitable pressures. What are those things? Bring them to God in prayer right now. And whatever they are, this isn't a prayer necessarily to solve them, though God, I think, wants to help us and solve lots of the problems that we have. This is an invitation to let God give you comfort right in the middle of those things. Coming up to Christmas, there's always problems with money and cash flow. At Christmas, there's always trouble with families and getting on and relationships and friendships. Coming up to Christmas, quite often we're aware of loneliness or we're aware of too many people sometimes. Sometimes when we're supposed to be enjoying ourselves, we find ourselves consumed with long-term worries and concerns. Whatever it is that holds us back from receiving God's comfort, just mention them to God and resolve, set your heart and mind to begin to receive God's comfort and reassurance and tender care in the midst of them, knowing that He is mighty to save and strong and good. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are strong and mighty and you are loving and tender. Thank you that you came to make it possible for us to receive that love and strength and tenderness. And today, Lord, we want to receive the good news in our hearts for ourselves in a real way, because we're faced with so many problems and difficulties and worries. Lord Jesus, speak a word of comfort and truth and love and grace into our hearts right now. As we reach out to you, Lord, would you meet us and reassure us of your great presence alongside us and inside of us too. Come into our hearts again, Lord, and begin to take control. Take control of all our anxieties and worries, all our difficult circumstances. Help us to know that whatever is happening, you are with us right now, loving us, providing for us. And you are with us forever as well. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the comfort that you are eager to give to us this day. And now, may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, may he comfort our hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Amen.
We're going to continue to pray through our Advent calendar by looking under the different doors as we go through, starting this week on door 15. And door 15 is Croft Street School Christmas boxes, which the Eden team are putting together. There's 50 boxes going over to Croft Street, full of food and other items to help families over the Christmas period. So pray that they are put together in time and that they will be a great blessing together with the Christian message, which is going into it as well. Next door is door number 16, and we're praying for the outdoor carol service taking place at 4 p.m. this afternoon. All 100 tickets have been sold, and we just need it to go well and safely this evening, and that people will have a really blessed time being together and singing God's praises. So pray for the outdoor carol service, and also that it won't rain too much. Uh, Our next door is door number 17 underneath the star. And that is the church building project. The applications have gone in. We're waiting to hear back on them. They've asked some questions. We've answered them. Or Gav has anyway. And we're waiting to hear. So pray for a successful outcome to the church building project application. The next door is, of course, door number 18, and this is church planting from St. Peter's. Things are starting to get serious. We've been talking to Beacon Church up on Feezy about whether they might like to receive a church plant from St. Peter's. And I, Chris, am going to go and start doing some ministry there in the new year to explore this further. So please pray for me, pray for them. Pray for us as a church that we will do something incredible for God's kingdom. Moving on to door number 19. And as Gav said earlier in the service, the very sad news of Brian Revel's death earlier this week. So we're going to spend some time just praying for Brian's family in their grief and sadness. And door number 20, another funeral this week is that of Doreen Shepherd, an elderly lady who lived locally, and her family who we've met this week. So let's pray for them. And our final door this week, door number 21. And our community at church and the wider community is in need of some serious joy, I think, at the moment. So let's pray for joy in our community this Christmas as we celebrate Christ coming to earth to live amongst us as that small baby and growing into the man that he became, who took on all of our sins, all of our wrongs, and brought us freedom. Freedom to be the people that God created us to be on the cross. What joy. Let's pray that we can experience it in our community over the coming weeks. We bring all these prayers together with a shout of Amen. within our hearts and within our church. May you be glorified, Lord Jesus. May your kingdom come. May your will be done. Amen.
Worthy of all our Stand.